Today's video aims to highlight three important reasons why natural logarithms are so important for modeling financial data. And who knows, perhaps the content of this video can land you your next fortune. Let's first motivate our topic and understand the basis of financial data by assuming that you recently landed a full-time job and you are doing amazing financially. So well, in fact, that you've quickly amassed $10,000 and you are trying to figure out what to do next with all of it. Your boss suggests that you invest the money in the company's retirement plan. And so you attend a workshop where some so-called investment guru, Frank, tries to sell you on his services. Now, during the workshop, Frank notes that if you invest with him, he'll help your money grow 10% each year. And on the surface, this sounds great. You quickly work out the math, and in 1 year, your $10,000 would become $11,000. And if you would like to retire in 30 years, you quickly work out that you would have $175,000 sitting in that retirement account. Huh, not too shabby. But as Frank quickly goes through his slides, you notice some fine print at the bottom of them. Namely, Frank will charge you a 2% fee of your investment value at the end of each year. And at first, 2% sounds pretty measly to you. But as you quickly work out the math, you realize that this small 2% fee means you'll have 40% less money in your account in 30 years. And so you leave this meeting saying to yourself, "Forget Frank, I'll figure out how to invest myself." Now, jokes aside, I'm not going to suggest in this video how you should invest your money, but what I can tell you is that if you delve into the world of finance, you'll notice that natural logarithms are discussed everywhere. So today, I want to explain to you three important reasons why this is the case, so that you are well equipped to model financial data on your own. Now, the very first reason why we like logarithms is that they help us linearize nonlinear data, which is important for modeling purposes. So let's go back to our original situation. You've earned $10,000 and Frank is selling you on his services, which he tells you will earn 10% on your money each year. Ignoring any taxes or fees, your money at any given year, T, should therefore be worth $10,000 scaled by some compound growth factor of 1.1 raised to the T. This is the general principle of compounding for investments. Now, the key aspect of this formula is that it is assuming your investment value will grow exponentially over time. And here is what is interesting. If I look at other financial data, you can clearly see that they also follow a similar shape. Here, I've pulled up two well-known financial time series, the S&P 500 and NASDAQ 100. While the data are not perfectly smooth, they generally follow this exponential trend curve over the last 40 to 50 years. So now let's discuss how logs linearize our data before discussing why we might want to do that. Let's plot some variable y that is increasing in some exponential fashion. Let's tabulate each of these observations, and once we've done that, let's rewrite each y in terms of the number of twos that would need to be multiplied together to yield y. This is the implicit meaning of logarithms, in this case log base 2. 2 raised to what exponent will yield y? And so, in other words, logarithms in a sense undo exponential functions, and so something that was more or less exponential can now be linearized. So now let's try to do the same thing with our two financial time series from earlier. If we take the logarithm of both financial time series, you can see that we arrive at something that looks much closer to a linear function. Now, why may you do this? Well, many techniques to model time series and financial data are designed to deal with linear systems, and I've listed here some examples. And so, if we can linearize our nonlinear systems, we have the tools available to us to begin to model them. So now that we understand that logarithms linearize our nonlinear data, why do we like something called natural logarithms? One of the principal reasons is that they have a nice tuition or meaning that does not exist for other logarithmic bases. Let's discuss this point by revisiting our earlier nonlinear set of observations. And as we just said, we can rewrite each value of y in terms of the number of twos that would need to be multiplied together to yield that result. In theory, we could also do this with 4 or any other base value, including e, which is the seemingly messy irrational number. In all of these cases, taking the log of y leads to a nice linear data set. So why should we select the base to be e, or what we typically refer to as the natural logarithm of y? One important reason is that it leads to easily interpretable statistical models. Now, what do I mean by that? Let's go back to Frank's proposition of earning you a 10% return each year. At the end of 30 years, we said that the investment would be worth $175,000, or simply 10,000 multiplied by 1.1 raised to the 30th. Now, I'm going to rewrite the equivalent value of $175,000, but in terms of E raised to the 0.0953 times 30. And here's what is interesting. 0.0953 is extremely close to 0.1. And what we can generally say is that E to the R is extremely close to 1 plus R. Alternatively, if I were to take the natural logarithm of both sides of this equation, then we can also say that R is approximately the natural log of 1 plus R. Is this universally the case? Absolutely not. Let's plot two different lines. First, y equaling r, and second, y equaling the natural log of 1 plus r. At first, these two functions look extremely different from each other. However, if we zoom in, we can note that they in fact are about the same, but only if r is very small. Fortunately for us, for financial data, r, or the growth rate for a financial investment, is typically quite small. In the case of the S&P 500, its average annual return has been just a tad over 10% for the last several decades. So now, why is this important? It is extremely valuable when we are analyzing financial data and want to make sense of our model results. To make this clear, let's try to generalize our investment opportunity with Frank. We can break our equation up into two parts. $10,000 represents our initial investment, and 1.1 raised to the t represents the investment's exponential growth over time. Let's generalize this equation so that c is any arbitrary initial investment, and now let's replace 1 plus r with e to the r, as we just said the two are approximately the same. And, as we mentioned earlier, we like to model financial data in log space to linearize our system, so let's transform it by taking its natural log. And, if we do, we arrive at the following equation, where we have an intercept term as well as an upward slope term. And remember, r approximately reflects our compound growth rate. So now let's imagine that we are analyzing the S&P 500 and NASDAQ 100. If we model them and estimate an upward trend term in natural log space, then the slope term approximately represents the typical growth rate for this series over time. And so by analyzing data in natural logs, our trend terms have a very nice intuitive meaning. Now, let's highlight the last reason we like to model our financial data in terms of natural logarithms, which is that it helps us model uncertainty. Remember, Frank has sold us on a 10% annual return, but let's be serious. That 10% annual return is likely uncertain, and it is likely to vary from year to year. And you can simply figure that out by looking at his past performance over time. So rather than believing that Frank will earn you a guaranteed 10% return every single year, let's analyze his past performance to estimate how the next 30 years may play out. And let's do so by analyzing logarithmic price changes. In other words, let's look at any time period T and look back at the value or price of his investments in that time step, say P sub T. We can also do the same thing for the adjacent time step, T plus 1. We can now say that the investment value in time T plus 1 should be equal to its previous value scaled by E to the R, or our approximate compound growth rate. We can now take the natural log of both sides of our equation and move the natural log of P sub t to the left-hand side of the equation. And if we do this for all time steps, we can analyze that data to come up with an approximate distribution for R, or our growth rate factor. Here, I've done this for monthly changes in the S&P 500 over the last 50 years. And what's interesting is that it follows pretty close to a bell-shaped normal distribution. It is not perfect, but it is still reasonably close. And for many financial datasets, we find this to be the case. Now, why is this important? Because the normal distribution has some really nice mathematical properties. And if you're interested in learning more about probability distributions further, I have just the video for you in the description. Now, let's assume that we have two normal distributions that are exactly the same. We typically measure the central tendency of a normal distribution with its mean, which we represent with the Greek letter mu, and its dispersion or uncertainty according to its variance, typically referred to as sigma squared. Let's suppose that we would like to add these distributions together, and for now, let's assume that they are independent from each other. the resulting distribution will be another normal distribution, but now with the mean and variance twice as large, or 2 mu and 2 sigma squared. And if these two distributions were not completely independent, we could also solve for the resulting distribution analytically. I won't step through that here in this video, but the key aspect is that our resulting distribution has a known distribution that we can model. This is an extremely important concept because then, through simple analytical means, we can quantify the uncertainty of, say, Frank's return over any time period. We can simply look at his past performance, understand that at each time step, there is some uncertain return R that he will be able to earn us, which we can quantify, of course, by analyzing past data. We can then rewrite his performance over the next 30 years in log space, which leads to the following nice additive equation. And because we assumed R follows a normal distribution, the resulting distribution of adding each of these random growth rates can be determined. And with that, we can now model our uncertain future returns. I decided to do this here by looking at monthly price changes in the S&P 500. I did so given that Frank is a fictional character, but also because the average annual return of the S&P 500 has been in the ballpark of around 10%. And with $10,000, I could easily compute the future expected value of this investment, as well as the uncertainty in that return. The blue lines here represent the 90 percentile central prediction interval of this investment value. Now, as mentioned, you may want to consider correlation over time, oftentimes referred to as autocorrelation, and you may prefer to model this time series slightly differently. But the key point here is that a nice analytical solution exists for this seemingly difficult problem. So my hope is that through today's video, you learned why natural logarithms are so important in modeling financial data. They help us linearize our systems, their coefficients have a clear intuitive meaning, and they help us model uncertainty. And with this bit of information, you are now well equipped to forget Frank and make plenty of money off on your own. Now, jokes aside, I want to end this video with two notes. First, as you might imagine in one short video, a lot of details were inevitably removed in terms of how you should go about modeling financial data, and so I've tried my best to provide relevant links in the description to fill in the gaps. And second, given how much time is put into each of these videos, I will be launching a blog later this summer where I can really dig into the details not covered in this video or others in a much more timely fashion. And I'll share that information once it is launched later this year. With that, thank you as always for your support of this channel. It really means a lot, and I look forward to seeing you soon.